Hello. Hello. Good evening. Very good. I'm so glad that you're able to make it for the 7 o'clock session. We had one at 5. You missed that one. Just kidding. Yeah, right? So, no, it's such a pleasure to see you all, because I know that we wanted to do it at 5, but I think Mark will explain it to you in a minute. Yeah. But I didn't want to cancel it. And so his flight landed around 5:30, and he rushed in here. So, refresh a little bit. Yeah. but he's here. Okay, so I'm so happy that all of you could make it at this time. Yeah. A very brief introduction about Mark. I mean, we actually circulated his bio and so on. Mark is a visiting professor at LKCSB. He's been so for 3 years now.
Yeah, 3 years.
And he'll continue to be so for the next several years. Yeah. And so we are really blessed to actually have him. I mean, so a person of this caliber does not happen every time, right? So, and so as it turns out, we were lucky to actually have this relationship before I knew Mark. I actually, we started the relationship with LVMH. As it turns out, part of the package with LVMH is you got to take him, okay? I thought
that's like Chris, like a stray dog.
Yeah, but I thought it was a strange request. Yeah, that we need to actually sort of the thing comes along. This relationship with LVMH comes Mark Ritson. So anyway, so lo and behold, we knew the moment we first saw him. I think it's the other way around. I think yeah. So Mark comes in and LVMH is an extra
vision.
Okay. Very good. Anyway, so I quickly, in terms of Mark has a PhD in marketing and from Lancaster. Subsequently, his first job was, I think, was it Minnesota, right?
Yeah.
Minnesota, but he actually worked at London Business School and at MIT. And what a stint it was, and I think every place he has actually gone, he literally gets the best teacher rating. And it's not easy, let me tell you, that at London Business School, they have masters, they have guys with incredible sort of credentials. And MIT, for a marketing professor to get the best professor award is almost impossible. I don't think anybody else got it since Mark left. Because MIT, as you know, is very technical. They like to sort of think in terms of themselves as technocrats, and marketing is all this fuzzy stuff that I think, yeah, so not. Anyway, so, and as it turns up here about 3 years ago, and he taught a brand strategy course, and I don't think, I was actually the director of the MBA program prior to that, and since then, I've not seen a person get 7 out of 7. The evaluations were perfect 7. That means there are 40 students, and even if somebody doesn't like that he didn't shave today, they would give less than a 7 grade, right? Yeah. So this was a perfect score, which actually was not heard of here. And so anyways, his record continues wherever he teaches, he has. And so Melbourne Business School essentially has been blessed to have him all these years. And so I'm just counting the number of times here. 2008, 2009, 10, 13, and 14, 5 times he was awarded the best teacher at Melbourne Business School as well. Okay, now that's his credentials in terms of as a PhD student and PhD and a faculty. But he has actually worked, and he's actually very proud to show off his lovely 20 years. And so think in terms of all the brands that we'd love to actually work with even once. He has worked with dozens of them, yeah. And he'll talk a lot in terms of about his experience with them. That's what actually makes it so fascinating to listen to him, yeah. And he's actually been an in-house professor and a consultant for LVMH for the last 13 years. And that is the fondness, I think, which LVMH has. So when they said, you need to have him, right? You need to actually sort of take him and then actually sort of incorporate. And I remember Ian Hardy, who was working with him at LVMH, he said, the reason why we want him here is that you actually absorb what he knows, which is an impossibility, let me tell you, right? Yeah. So, but effectively, I think he's been a fantastic sort of a colleague of ours. And so he flew in, he was supposed to fly in this morning, but he'll tell you with the vagaries of travel these days, yeah. But more importantly, I just met this gentleman from Sentosa Resorts World. And so I was thanking him to come for coming at 7 o'clock. He said, I won't miss it because English. And so this guy is a columnist. He actually writes columns in UK for Marketing Week. and has been the best columnist by the PPA Press Awards, and so he's now a columnist for Australia. So all these aside, I mean, see, he's actually a fantastic scholar. His research has gotten one of some of the best research awards. There's something called the Odell Award, which is given to the best marketing or doctoral thesis. Yeah, in his early years, and I think this was a fascinating one. I didn't know. Yeah. So his research on pricing was cited by George Akerlof. Akerlof is an economist. Fascinating one at that. He got Nobel Prize in economics, and in his acceptance speech. So he actually cited Mark Ritson. So, yeah, you got a whole picture. You know how much I admire him. Yeah. Okay. So, and I'm very thankful that that you were able to make time to come at this late hour. And I don't think you will be wrong in actually sort of at least sparing this much time on a Friday evening. Okay. Mark, without much ado.
Thank you, Rudy. So yes, my apologies. I have a lovely Canali suit that I was going to wear for tonight's session, but there was problems with the plane coming out last night, and so I slept in the airport last night and got off the plane about an hour and 20 minutes ago. So I apologise for my rather casual demeanour. I have stains here and a few, well, I haven't shaved, but I have made it here.
It was your perfect score.
And it's, yeah, so the brief tonight is to talk about general things, but. As Shri's mentioned, I worked for LVMH for about 13 years as a sort of in-house professor or consultant, and then I kind of retired and came to SMU, really. But I've worked for a large range of companies, and what I'll do tonight is really talk about some of the key lessons from some of these companies, and by no means these are going to be just, you know, I have learned this because I'm a genius, blah, blah, blah. They're live lessons, and some of them are going on as we speak, right? And I wanted to make it more discursive so we can maybe have a debate as we go. So yeah, I've worked for a very large broad range of companies, and tonight I'd like to talk about lessons from luxury brands, but also some of the other brands that I've worked for as well. And actually I've got nine, I think there's nine here. And what I'd like to do in an hour is get through the nine pretty fast, and then try and get a discussion going about them, because they are, as I've just said, live thing. So I'm going to talk about targeting, because it's become a hot topic again. I'm going to talk about brands over time. The issue of media neutrality in Adidas, which is interesting. Killing. Then the sort of LVMH concepts of brand DNA and brand codes, and I'll explain what these things mean. The murkiness of the media world. So it's a real mess out there, and I'm not sure how much in Singapore you're aware of what's going on, but it's very dirty and very murky and very strange. And I think, you know, my attitude is I'm just going to talk about it even though it's secret. So we'll talk about that later on. Zero-based budgeting, which is probably the biggest trend in marketing at the moment and will be a major one for the next couple of years. And then a bit on disruption at the end, okay? And we will share a version of the slides. We'll take out a couple of confidential things probably, but most of these slides you will get, okay, I promise. So let's start with targeting. This is the latest Ferrari that's not yet available, but soon to be available, called La Ferrari. Does anyone know what the targeting strategy is for La Ferrari? Who they're going after with this new sports car? Quite a famous targeting strategy. Who's their target market for this new car? Does anyone know?
Owners with at least five other Ferraris.
Yes, sir, exactly right. You must have already purchased five new Ferraris to even be considered for this one. And that's the kind of targeting, it's all true as well, that's the kind of targeting that within the world of luxury we sort of got used to. We went after, you know, the VIC client, it was very, literally it was a needle in a haystack, quite. The interesting issue is targeting is probably the most debated topic in marketing right now. And there is a huge debate at most of the large marketing companies as to whether they should even bother doing it anymore. So Byron Sharp, who some of you may have heard of, and if not, you soon will, is the most famous marketing professor in the world. What's been happening in American business schools, tragically, is most of them don't know anything about marketing, and it is a tragedy. Of my generation and Trini's, we went to America because they literally invented marketing there, and you went to Wharton, or you went to Cornell, or you went to Stanford, because there were marketing professors there that knew more than people in India or the UK or anywhere else. That has stopped. And I do fear for marketing because of it. So in these great big American business schools, you'll find now many marketing academics have no practical marketing experience, have no undergraduate qualification in marketing, don't have a PhD in marketing. They're either quant jocks or psych or something else, or economists. And that means they're largely quiet about the discipline of marketing, which is a great loss. And so Byron Sharp, who's actually based in Adelaide, has written the most important book on marketing called How Brands Grow. It is, Byron is very strong on, you know, going after a lot of the myths of marketing. And I think that, and I know for a fact, this book is in the briefcase of almost every CMO I've ever met. It's not a particularly good book in the sense that it's a pain to read. I think it's terribly written. It's about 60%, 70% true in my opinion, but some bits are wrong, but you know, you like to think that. These are his seven principles, and I buy all of them, but pretty much, I think it's the contribution he makes is huge. But the top one is the one that I'd like to focus on. So one of his seven principles of how brands grow is continuously reach all buyers of the category. And this is what Byron refers to as sophisticated mass marketing. So, you know, the idea that mass marketing would come back into favor is, you know, bizarre. We left that world 50 years ago. But there is no doubt that there are many senior marketers now who see targeting as old-fashioned and mass marketing as the future of the discipline. And just to prove it, this is an excerpt from his book. Past worldview is target marketing. New worldview is sophisticated mass marketing. And these are actual quotes from CMOs. This is Bruce McColl, who's just retired as the CMO of Mars, very successful. He said last year, "I'm not a great believer in targeting. Our target is about 7 billion people sitting on this planet. Our task is to reach as many people as we can, to get them to notice us and remember us, to nudge them and hopefully get them to buy us once more this year." That's a literal definition of mass marketing, right? Mm. Mark Pritchard, the CBO of P&G, the most important marketer in the world. "We targeted too much and we went too narrow, and now we're looking at the best way to get the most reach but also the right precision." So this is someone saying over-targeting, right? And the bit of Byron's book that speaks to this is he refers to it as sophisticated mass marketing, which doesn't mean targeting everyone, nor does it mean treating everyone the same. It means understanding the heterogeneity in your market and then catering for only the differences that matter. And so I think it's very dangerous to talk about mass marketing with most marketers who are desperate to do that, right? I think to be fair to him though, if most segmentations I've seen in my career have been totally pointless. And what I mean by that is, I mean, obviously demographics are pointless, right? It can't be that basic. And I'm stunned by, you know, millennials and the use of the term millennials. Millennials do not qualify as a segment on any possible definition. Clearly there is a group who are aged, you know, across a 17-year span. But in every piece of empirical research I've ever seen that attempts to show behavioral or attitudinal differences between that group and older people, we discover absolutely nothing. And yet, this term millennials continues to be shared around as if it has any validity at all. Think about the stupidity of it, right? The idea that anyone born within a 17-year span has similar attitudinal or behavioral traits, all of them, what? That can't be accurate. It doesn't qualify as a segment. It's lazy marketing, yeah? It's a bullshit segment. And the data, which many people have published as millennials in the workforce, millennials as customers, shows that the difference between a millennial and another millennial is likely to be just as great as the difference between a millennial and a Gen Xer. But no one seems to bother, and they just keep referring to millennials as if they're some kind of real group. So anyway, I think that's what Byron's talking about. Most segmentation is bullshit. It doesn't actually show you differences of behavior. It's just arcane demographic slices. And what should trouble you as well is we live in a world where you're not meant to judge people by their race or their age or their gender. So why are we doing it with race and age and particularly gender? It doesn't sound politically correct either. Anyway, So I come from an old world now, I'm getting old. I believe in the holy trinity of marketing, that's what I teach here. I believe that you segment, and then you target, and then you position. And I believe that because I was taught to do it. And I believe that because it has made me and my clients extraordinary large amounts of money. So it has worked for me. And in my life, I don't care how you segment the market, but once you segment it, that decision of who you target and who you don't is pure strategy. Yeah. Segmentation is about the market. It's got nothing to do with the firm. If two companies in the same industry do segmentation, in theory, they should come up with the same segmentation. But targeting is about you. And targeting is a pure strategic decision. Or, as Michael Porter famously says, the essence of strategy is choosing what not to do. And the essence of targeting is really all about who you don't go for rather than who you do. And most marketers end up going after everyone and thereby making it pointless. So, my point is, I really believe in targeting, and therefore I have a real problem with this mass marketing approach. So I offer you no answers on this one, but it is a massive debate at the highest levels of the biggest companies in America and Europe right now. We started with mass marketing and Henry Ford. We moved to a world that Trini and I are familiar with, which is, you know, you target a segment and you go after them, and ideally just one segment so you can really focus in on them. But in recent years, of course, we've had our friends at Facebook with micro-targeting. And I don't know how many of you have actually done this yet, but when you actually do work with Facebook, the granularity of the segments you can achieve are truly stunning now, right? You know, in terms of how you can slice that data. But we now, with Byron, have sophisticated mass marketing as well. So what this means is the targeting question is back in play very much, right? And you can go from literally going after a very tiny segment of the population. You have two cats, a very expensive house, a very house proud, are thinking of selling their house in the next 6 months, and are particularly interested in cleanliness, right? You can buy that segment all the way across to literally everyone. And I guess what this means for you and what the issue says is, you're going to have to decide as a marketer what your philosophy on targeting is first, before you then pick the targets you want to go after. Because targeting is a gigantic debate again, and it will only get bigger, I think, over the next 2 years. Number two, time. So, one of the great brands of LVMH is Christian Dior. In many cases, sort of the most popular one within the group. Dior is a very interesting character. He actually was an architect. He came to couture very late in life and started his house in 1947, just after World War II, and died in 1957. And when he died, he set up easily the most famous fashion house along with Chanel in the world. And we had this amazing moment when the brand was born. So this is a very famous picture from the archives of Dior. It shows a woman, a model actually, that was wearing one of the first Dior gowns, made in 1947. And Richard Avedon was trying to take a photograph showing sort of, you know, high fashion in the streets of Paris. But these two old women suddenly turned up and ripped the dress off her and left her naked in the street. And they were enraged by how exuberant and glamorous this dress was. And to our eyes, you might think, well, why would that dress make anyone angry? But the key is it was 1947 in France, and it was a time of great austerity. And so to wear something so glamorous and feminine was a real provocation, hence the fact that they ripped it off her. And so when you study this moment, it informs Dior's perception and brand, right? It was always about glamour and femininity, but it was also about provocation. There was a little bit of provocation here. So anyway, what happens next is Dior dies, a young Yves Saint Laurent takes over for a few years, and if ever there was a photograph to capture the pressures of LVMH management, this is Yves Saint Laurent at Mr. Dior's funeral outside his house. And obviously he's sad because his mentor is dead, but he's also sad, and I know this look, he's sad because he's taking over the house and he isn't mature or experienced enough to handle it yet. And you can feel the weight of the maison sitting on his shoulders already. Marc Bohan then takes over for nearly 30 years, followed by Gianfranco Ferre. Then we get to the Galliano era, and then, of course, Ralph Simons and the new woman, Madame Thury, who's just taken over. Okay. The point I'm going to make here, though, is if we zoom back to this period, if you look at what Jean-Franco Ferré was designing for Dior in the late 90s, you can see that it's thoroughly and totally boring, yeah? Isabella Gianni's bored, he's bored, everyone. It's boring, you know? Now that's ironic because it's not that different from those gowns you saw earlier. When Galliano was hired, the team at what became LVMH studied the history of Dior. And one of his first collections was called Hobo Chic. And John used to jog by the Seine River. And he saw the homeless sleeping in newspaper and he thought that was great. So he designed a ready-to-wear collection inspired by the homeless tramps of Paris. And when he started talking about how this was a big inspiration for him and how he loved this, it caused a major scandal. And there was actually a protest outside Dior's headquarters or whatever you wanted. And the CEO, Mr. Toledano, was, you know, the staff came and said, Mr. Toledano, there's a protest. And he said, fantastic, at last we have, you know, got the brand back. Because the point is, it had a little bit of provocation, it wasn't afraid of that. So here's the bit that I'm trying to make here. This dress are kind of similar, they're almost identical. So what's intriguing to me is, and I see this many times, by trying to do the same thing, you become inconsistent with your brand. Yeah? That over time, what was provocative and glamorous to the eyes of a woman in 1947 becomes boring and traditional to the eyes of a woman of 1997. And the paradox you're glimpsing here is, when brands reach a certain age, they must change in order to remain true. Now you don't see that for the first 10 or 20 years. In fact, in my experience, you see it around 40 years. When the brand is older than the clients it targets, suddenly it has to work much harder to become true to itself. What was once natural has to be tweaked a bit more than normal, yeah? So that's the paradox. If you don't change, you eventually become inconsistent with the brand that you once were. For business schools, you know, whether we launch digital MBAs is a huge question to it, and I don't know the answer. But the point is, you know, schools of significant age need to be careful because what they did 100 years ago will surely not serve them for the next 100 years. That's a big paradox. Let me show you an Aussie example from this week, which has been fascinating in Australia. I don't know if you know Cooper's beer or not. It's a very famous Australian beer. Their sparkling ale is one of the top four sold Australian beers. And I love this story. So last week, Cooper's sponsored the Bible Society in Australia. And they do that because Cooper's is a very old South Australian brand. And whenever a company or organization, they've done the unions before, Flinders University, in this case the Bible Society, when a big institution has a centenary, Cooper's does like a limited edition bunch of cans where they put, you know, congratulations, a little Bible verse on it. It was all very harmless. Anyway, what happened next was the Bible Society then took that as a signal they could have a massive event in Canberra where we have the Australian Parliament, where they'd have three politicians debating marriage equality. Now in Australia, I don't know how things are politically, in Singapore they're slightly different. In Australia, about 90% of the population is in favor of marriage equality for people of any sexual orientation. And Coopers apparently were sponsoring a debate from three white, middle-aged, right-wing MPs to discuss whether or not that really made any sense. Probably not, we shouldn't let them get married, that's not the right thing. Now, this is the typical kind of debate that happens with right-wing politicians, but the question that about 20 million Australians asked at the same time is, what is Coopers doing in the middle of that? And the answer is, Coopers didn't know about it. And so the Bible Society had taken those special limited edition cans and run this event, claiming that Coopers was sponsoring it. And so the Coopers guys, they're really nice and kind of boring, you know? And so they released a press release as this thing started to pick up attention, where they said, look, with regard to that video from the Bible Society, Coopers isn't trying to push religious messages or change your beliefs by celebrating 200 years of these guys. We're just supporting. But this is a very nice thing to do because they literally didn't know about the event and they're still supporting it. A day later, when the whole of Australian newspapers were covered with Coopers is anti-marriage equality, there was a bit of a stronger press release. Coopers have released a commemorative cans of light beer to celebrate the Bible Society's 200th anniversary. We want you to know that Coopers did not give permission for our beer to feature in the Bible Society's Keeping It Light video. So now they were being a bit stronger. But it was too late, because people were saying, but why do the cans say the Bible Society? You're obviously supporting this. At which point they brought in proper crisis management. So by now, people are now, I mean, Coopers is, you know, very widely drunk in Australia, and everyone started banning it. People were pouring on the streets last week. Most bars said we're not going to serve it anymore. At which point they brought in proper crisis management experts and asked the two Coopers that still run the brewery to give a very short Al-Qaeda style statement where they said, listen, you know, we are absolutely and completely not in favour of any of this. We have listened, we have learned, etc. And to be fair, they solved the problem. The interesting question is, why on earth did Coopers do this? And the answer is brands get old. So this is Coopers brand positioning, as you can see. Australian made, family owned, Australian icon, relaxing enjoyment, family values and tradition. Now, with all those in mind, if you're a 65-year-old bloke, like the managing director of Coopers, Dr. Tim Cooper, I think that the Bible Society fits all of those. The problem is he's not the target market anymore for Coopers. According to Coopers' own marketing, the target market is 18 to 34-year-olds, university students and young professionals, optimistic about the future, socially aware. 100% of them believe in marriage equality. And so I think what you're seeing is a classic example of what brands once did. 20 years ago, you could have sponsored the Bible Society. You can't do it now because the Bible Society has taken a stance that the target market don't agree with. And I think this lesson is a big one, right? When brands turn about 40, they have to start working out in the gym, yeah? Like men. Women are always beautiful for their whole lives, but when men turn 40, they have to start working out or things start dropping off, you know? And we went through this with Dom Perignon, you know? We really were an iconic brand. And I also remember my boss at the time saying to me, I don't want to be an icon, because an icon is cold, and it sits on a wall, and everyone likes it, but nobody ever drinks it. You know, we want to be drunk and enjoyed and consumed. And we set out on a mission about 10 years ago to deliberately refresh the brand. And you know, at the time, people said, "Oh, that's not very nice. You can't have neon green balls." Listen, we needed to refresh the brand, right? And you need to shake it up a little bit. Media neutrality. Wow, right? You want to get amongst it? Here you go. So this is Kasper Rorschach, he's the new CEO of Adidas, and I think I called him a moron this week in the press. No, I didn't call him a moron, what he said was moronic, okay? So let's look at his moronic statement and then we can talk about it, right? It's not really his fault, it's very typical. So, last week on TV he said, it's clear that the younger consumer engages with us predominantly over the mobile device. Digital engagement is key for us. You don't see any TV advertising anymore. All of our engagement with the consumer is through digital media. And we believe in the next 3 years we can take our online business from 1 billion to 4 billion and create a much more direct engagement with consumers. So this made a lot of headlines, you know, Adidas is moving not to a digital first model, but a digital only model from what the CEO is saying. There are many problems with that. I appreciate in Singapore this is not going to go down well because it's a very digitally oriented place, but I'm going to go after it. So, did you not notice there was this social media revolution where advertising was finished? Do you remember Mark Zuckerberg saying that? We're going to have relationships, conversations between brands and people, and that was going to replace these 20th century advertising models. And did you also not notice that that did not work? Yeah? That even the biggest brand got less than 1% of its customer base to actually follow it on any of the social media platforms. And did you also not notice that at some point we realized that and moved to digital marketing instead? It troubles me greatly that we spent 5 years arsing about with social media and had social media managers and all of that, and no one ever pointed out at the end, ooh, that didn't really work, did it? But it definitely didn't work. And if you want proof of that, at the end of last year, MediaPost voted BBDO in America as Advertising Agency of the Year. And the reason they gave the award to BBDO was the lingering model of organic, always-on content creation for brands has become inefficient and ineffective. And BBDO had come up with a report called A New Approach to Facebook for Big Brands. Yeah. The model, which was developed by BBDO's communications planning team, found that while 97% of the top 100 brands still rely on organic postings on Facebook, they've become largely ineffective. The solution? Utilize Facebook not as a social network, but a media channel. So did you notice how that happened, right? Anyone who's these social media managers and all of that, fundamentally it was pointless, right? They got no engagement at all. And we moved subtly to digital marketing, which does make a lot more sense. And what digital marketing is, if you ever noticed, is TV ads and print ads on digital devices. That's what it is. What's wrong with that? Different devices. But there's a new nonsense now flooding the world. And the new nonsense is that now digital is everything, and TV and print, radio and shit, they're all dying. Yeah? In fact, they're nearly done. This is totally not true. It has never been true. I'll show you data to prove that it's not true. Facebook know it's not true. Their own data shows it's not true. The people that don't know it's not true are all the marketers who are spending money on it. It is a gigantic and incredible story that no one discusses. So traditional media is dying and digital is replacing it, especially for millennials. Let's look at some objective independent data. This is the Nielsen data from the United States. It came out last week. The red bar is live TV watching from a representative sample of American households. You notice Q3, 16, 15, and 14. That's the average number of hours per day. You see how that number are pretty much the same? You know what that tells you? People are watching the same amount of TV now. And it's enormously more than anything else. Here's an interesting chart. Now, you say, what about the millennials now, right? Oh, what about second screening? And these are all true. So millennials definitely are watching less TV than old people. That's because they're young and they go out and do stuff. They'll get old, trust me, it happens. They are also watching less TV than their predecessors in the noughties and 90s. Yeah, that's also true. But TV remains the predominant source of video for these people, and the data is very clear on that. So this data shows you over the last 7 years, 18 to 24 year olds, how much TV they watch. And you're absolutely right, look, it is declining, yeah? But look what it was, it's still, 100, whatever that is, minutes a day, whatever it might be. But look at the decline year on year, and you'll see that it's starting to flatten out. Yeah? It's flattening, it went down significantly, but it's starting to flatten. TV is not news media, in the sense that it remains, the spot prices remain very strong, the reach beats Facebook or Google or YouTube by a phenomenal degree. You can't reach the audiences that you want to reach in most big countries without TV, even if it's a millennial audience. Here's the UK data. I like this data. This is from Thinkbox. So the UK, we have BBC, as you know, that's that top bit there, okay? The indigo one down here is commercial TV with advertising. That's the amount of TV viewed on average by the typical British person over the last 10 years. You can see the internet access went from 47 to nearly doubled, and you can see the grand effect that had on TV, commercial TV watching was nothing. That's a giant panel of households, and it's flat as a pancake. It's a myth that was broadcast. And what appears to emerge is that certainly digital media is growing. It's certainly an important tool, but it isn't at the people are spending more time consuming with second screen rather than switching from TV, which is dying. At some point, the predictions of the death of TV have to end because it's not dying, right? I don't know how long it's going to take for people to realize that that red line is flat, but at some point, they will hopefully realize. And here again is the data for millennials. Yes, watching less TV, but flattening out as well. The data, which whenever you hear someone say TV is down, you should ask someone to show you some data. The data is pretty straightforward. So back to Rorschach. So the reason why Rorschach is wrong, first of all, is because TV isn't a pointless medium. But the main reason is he's completely wrong at a strategic level. So in the 1990s, we invented a thing called media neutrality. And here's what media neutrality means. It means you don't know what media you need until you finish your strategy. And if you're a digital marketer, you have no idea what you're doing. It's very hard to be media neutral if your title says digital marketing. Yeah? Very hard, right? And my point isn't to hammer digital. I think it's a great tool. I mean, I've worked for Sephora and Benefit, pretty much 100% digital. That makes perfect sense. But the point is, we didn't get to those digital investments by going, we're going to spend all of our money on digital this year. We said, let's finish our strategy, let's look at our targets, let's look at our position, and then let's decide the best media. And we evaluated it each year. That's what's called being a proper marketer. Yeah? I'm not saying we wouldn't spend all of it on digital. What I'm saying is every year, I'm going to have a look and see if radio or TV can give me better value for money for my brands. That's all we're saying. That's all media neutrality says, right? Tactics after strategy. Yeah? You can't have digital strategy. Digital is a tactic. It's a very important tactic. Strategy remains strategy. Who are we going after? What is our position? What is the objective of our communication? And then we'll have a look at tactics. And so I think what Rorschach's doing here is sending his organization off on a wobbly. The minute a company ring-fences a certain amount of its money to spend on digital, it's moronic. I'm not saying they should spend money on digital, I'm saying spend all of it, but get your strategy done first. And I can't read that, it's a bit rude. But what disappoints me is the reaction I get on social media is, why is Ritson so positive for TV, right? I wrote a very simple article that says, media neutrality means you have to hate all media and be skeptical of all media. You can't have Facebook sitting at the end of your table helping you to plan your strategy for the year. That's not how this is meant to work, right? That's all I said. But it's perceived as, why does he like TV so much? I don't like TV that much. I don't like any media that much, right? Show me a strategy and I want to let them fight over my brand. That's the point, right? We used to do that really well, but digital marketing has soured that. So yeah, strategy first. I want a target, I want a position, I want objectives, and then we can talk about it, right? And this is the killer point, yeah? In all my experiences with brands, this simple formula is a very important formula. A times B is always more than 2A or 2B, yeah? And what I mean by that is you can choose two communication tools. Let's do Facebook and outdoor. You ready? I'd be better off if I have a Facebook campaign taking 10 or 20% of that money and putting it into outdoor. It will give me a better return than if I spent all of it on Facebook or all of it on outdoor or all of it on TV. The interactions and synergies of multiple media mean you always want to spread your money across multiple tools in the appropriate way. And we've got shed loads of data to prove it. If any of these morons that are spending the money ever looked at it, right? This is a meta analysis of 5 years of 3,200 campaigns, okay, over 5 years done by Peter Field, okay? One platform, so it's the degree to which you get an incremental return, right? Two platforms gives you a plus 19% impact on average over just putting all your money on one platform. Plus 23% if you have three, plus 31 if you have four, and plus 35 if you have five. You spread your money across different tools. The interaction effects, the 360 effects, give you a much better return. Difficult to do when you're a digital marketer and you won't touch outdoor or radio because it's not digital. But let's pause and let me just prove the madness. So either I'm crazy or the whole world's crazy. You ready? Digital marketing literally doesn't exist. Name me a non-digital media. Give me one. Everyone's talking about digital media. Give me one. Give me an advertising medium that is traditional, that's not digital.
Radio.
Which one? Radio. Because it's not like 45% of Americans listen to radio digitally now. It's true. They do. Give me another one. Come on, give me one. Which one? Newspapers. It's not like 42% of British people don't look at the newspaper on a tablet every morning. Give me another. Spend all night here, trust me. Outdoor, yes, outdoor billboards, yeah? It's not like 50% of all Australian billboards are now digital and going through programmatic. You see the madness of this? Name me a tool that's not, it's all fucking digital.
Assessment.
But they wouldn't be included in advertising media, right? But that's a good one. But yeah, I mean, the Salesforce, I mean, they are, to be fair, they're using these point-and-click things, but yeah, they're not in the media. The advertising media are all digital, yeah? The madness of this. So what are we saying to digital marketers? Are you going to, when we pass 50% of all billboards, as they are in Australia now, are digital screens, are you going to now do that for us? And because radio is now 45%, you're going to do that? See what I mean? It's a nonsense. The D word is stupid. Stupid. All it is media. Yeah? Everything's digital. We'll come back to that point later. All right, killing stuff. But you see my point, right? You see my point? Everyone's talking about digital. It doesn't mean anything. It doesn't, Nicholas Negroponte at MIT said 15 years ago, like air and drinking water, digital will soon be only noticed by its absence, not by its presence. Everything is digital, and the sooner we get rid of the D word, the sooner we can do proper marketing. All right, killing stuff. What do we have work with is a woman called Nikki Clarkson, who is a wonderful marketer who runs the largest, I think, radio company in Australia. And these are the radio stations that she is in charge of, right? Now, Australia isn't that big a country. It's bigger than Singapore, but everything is, right? But it's got a lot of stations. And so late last year, Nikki was able to do a little bit of brand consolidation and got her 68 stations down to 6 going on with 5. This is the future. Yeah? Most companies have too many brands. And when you try and juggle lots of balls, you drop them all on the floor. And their results have been spectacular ever since. When you kill brands, you are more profitable, you grow faster, you're better. And there is a strong correlation with killing and success. And in fact, I was talking day before last at Ogilvy, who've killed about a dozen brands within their agency network, and I've just gone back to being the Ogilvy brand. Focus and killing to get there are big things. This, hey, does anyone recognize this sheep?
Oh yes,
sheep.
Which sheep?
I've got the name. But
Shrek. This is Shrek.
Yeah.
And Shrek was able to avoid being rounded up by the sheep, the shepherds, for many years by hiding in a cave. Until, as you can see here, she couldn't actually see anymore and her feet didn't work. And so finally they rounded her up and managed to shear her. Right? She's much happier now, much happier. But my point is, if your company hasn't killed brands recently, this is how it looks. Yeah? Companies grow brands like sheep grow wool, and you have to shear them regularly to get the focus back. If you don't, profitability, marketing, and everything begins to struggle. And I don't know about Singapore. In Australia, this has been our biggest problem. All these companies you see here, all these companies are Australian companies now run by foreign organizations or countries. And all of them had more brands than P&G, but less than 1% of P&G's profits. And the point is, we in Australia, we just thought more brands was the answer. And actually, more brands is the opposite of the answer. I learned this from LVMH more than anywhere else. So this is Jean-André Rougeau. He's the CEO of Benefit, and he would be up there as one of the best CEOs in LVMH. And one of the things he did very nicely, I think, from the early days was he set a limit of how many SKUs, how many products Benefit could have. And so if somebody turned up and said, oh, I've got a new, beautiful new mascara, he was, that's fabulous. How many? Oh, 6 SKUs. No, no problem. Just give me the 6 SKUs that we're going to get rid of, right, to replace them with. And this is a great way of keeping the sheep well sheared. I worked 2 weeks ago for an Australian company who had 4% of SKUs account for 50% of sales. That's not unusual in a company that hasn't cut, right? And it's a signal that you need to get the shears out quite quickly. In my consulting career, I've created 2 brands so far, and I've killed more than 250. And I'm very happy with that ratio, right? Moronic brand consultants want to create brands and brand extensions and cost money and lose things. Smart ones want to tighten and focus and kill. Killing is good. In fact, killing is essential. And to illustrate the point, we could look at the case of the brown rat. So the brown rat, Rattus norvegicus, is a very successful mammal. It's successful because it inhabits every single place except for Antarctica. And it's successful because right now, almost certainly, we are less than 4 meters away from a rat. Somewhere in the walls, somewhere in the floorboards, there will be rats running around as we speak. Why is the rat so successful? The rat, the brown rat, is so successful because it practices an extraordinarily gruesome thing. The brown rat commits infanticide. She eats her own babies. So, on average, a brown rat will have 3 litters a year, averaging 6 pups. The dam rat, the mother rat, when she gets cold or hungry, will pick out the weakest runt in the litter, and she will kill and consume it. And in many cases, she will eat half of her own litter. Now, that's a gruesome thought, especially around dinner time, but it's absolutely essential to the success of the brown rat, who only has two directives in life. One, the mother rat must survive to breed again, and two, as many of her babies must survive so they too can breed. Now, what's the moral of this gruesome story for companies? Turn the mother rat into your company and turn the pups into your brands. Too many brands suckling on the corporate teat kills everything. And this is the story of Australia. Too many brands means that all brands die, including the mother brand as well. We must learn, like the brown rat, to kill in order to be successful and to grow. Another way to think about it is, too many marketers are Buddhist in their orientation on brands. All life is good and must be celebrated. It's the wrong god for the decade we live in. More of us should be following Shiva. And this idea that death can be also a very positive, enlightening thing. Brand DNA. So one of the things that LVMH has done well, I think, is work out what its brands stand for. So I'll show, this is the worst brand consulting gig I've ever seen. So I've seen some shit in my time, but this is the worst I've ever seen. Yeah, why not? Let's talk about it. Everyone talks about the good stuff. Let's talk about the bad stuff. So this is MetLife, which is a large American insurance company, and they have, I'm sure they've changed it maybe since, but this is the worst brand positioning work I've ever seen. So MetLife have a positioning statement, which is that it is a leading international provider of insurance, other financial products, and indivisible financial freedom for our customers. So they can focus on what matters most in life. You know, it's a bit generic and it's a bit long-winded, but it'll do. But on top of the positioning statement, they also added a series of brand values. People count, integrity and honesty, innovation, financial strength, partnership, personal building. Already that's too much, right? But they weren't finished. They also added a statement of purpose. And then they also put on top of that a long-term goal. And then added to that some core attributes. And someone said, well, I think you have core attributes, you should also have secondary attributes as well. And then someone else said, I think we need a theme, yeah, to add it all together. And someone else said, I think we need like a brand, online brand center to explain what all this means. And said, well, we need a glossary to go through all the terms, right? Madness, right? The point here is that people are trying to do their best, but they've just completely ruined it all, right? What is the point of brand positioning? It's that if I send my sales reps out to sell insurance, they know what to deliver. But if you give them all this crap, they haven't got a clue. And so I think what LVMH did very well, I'm biased because I was part of the team that did this, is we got it down to four or five words, and that was it. And we didn't allow anything else. So our concept of brand DNA was it came from history, but partly because I was doing most of the workshops at the time, if you needed more than you can't have more than one slide, and ideally two or three words to define the brand. Any moron can come up with 40 words, but it's pointless. The triangles and the keyholes and all that crap, right? To define a brand with three or four words and get it right, and where we can actually, you know, think about it and use it, is a different matter. So this was the idea of DNA, and all of our brands have clear and distinct genes, usually three or four genes that define their brand. This is the work we did for Dom Perignon, which I think was pretty good. And, you know, we use this in pretty much everything we do going forward. You see all this crap here? It all means the same thing. It really does. At some point, we let consultants and professors complicate things. And all the time I get people saying to me, oh, but, yeah, the value proposition is different from the brand promise. And I go, no, it's not. No, it's not. You're an idiot. No, it's not. Right? All of this shit means the same thing, right? In business school, we would call it positioning. But even that, you don't have to call it that. Here's what it is. It's the intention. It's what the brand is meant to stand for when you think about the brand. And every time you add another one of those bullet points to your strategy, the chances of getting that through diminish exponentially. You don't need, I mean, I see all of these, right, in these brand books. Nonsense. Yeah? Bureaucrats. Here's the thing, I'm going to borrow your beautiful head here, so you've got a lovely head. if this gentleman's my target customer, right, I want to get three things into his. First of all, I want brand awareness. He has to know that I exist. Don't forget that. And then second, I want him to think. The three things I want him to think about the brand now that he knows I exist. Those three things, that's what you put in your position. And you know, you can call it anything you like. Call it magic movie. I don't care. But that's what DNA is, right? We want you to feel those things about our brand if you know we exist. Everything else is ephemera. So, positioning is not an end in itself. You know, creating charts and presentations is pointless. Positioning is a means to an end, and the end is brand equity. I want my customer to think three things about my brand. Well, you know what? That's what I'm going to put in the position. And I can call it magic moonbeams, happiness, brand DNA. It doesn't bloody matter. Whatever makes your life easier. And all that crap means the same thing. Okay. So, So, the most lucrative work I ever got to do, and I've done some lucrative work, trust me, was I used to do consulting work in America on big brand jobs. Did you ever get any of this action, Trini? So, when a company spends more than $1 million on something, many of them in the procurement department want an external expert to validate the work, right? So, I got on this list somehow where I get flown out, in this case to California. Very large retailer had had a very large brand consulting job done, and all I had to do was turn up and go, I'm a professor and this is very good work, right? Yeah. 30, 40, 50,000 bucks, right? So normally when I go to a consulting gig, like I got to do work, you know, I'm like very depressed, I'm I used to skip to these ones, right? First class flight to San Francisco, right? Criticize someone else's work, get 50 grand, go home, drink all the way home, right? It was better. And all I had to do to keep getting this work, because I was on the list, right? This guy from Australia, sign off, was just not questioning. See what I mean? Just found a sign of thing. Found money, everything's groovy, right? So I did this one in California, and I can't show you it or anything. This is what this looks exactly like it, right? So the large brand consulting team presenting it to the executive team. And I was in the back, you know, just trying to, you know, just count my money, right? well, that's my job, right? And then the woman that was presenting it, the partner, she got to this slide, which was the brand essence, you know? And it looked exactly like this. And I thought, you know, fuck it, I'm going. And I went, I'm the professor at the back, sorry, I'm just one quick question. This is it, right? This is the brand essence. And she went, yeah. And I said, you haven't got anything else? No, this is it. So this has been like a 9-month project, it's cost like $3 million. So yeah. And so I got up and I walked up to the front, and one of the ninja skills of PowerPoint is if you press W, the screen goes white, yeah? And if you press B, it goes black. And so I just turned the screen off and I went back and sat down. I said, all right, well then you can tell me what these words are without having the slide in front of you, can't you? And I left her there for, I reckon, about 4 minutes. Before she was done, I think she got 6 out of the 28 words. And when she was finished, I said, right, that's the problem with people like you. Oh, I really did say this. That's the problem with people like you, your company. You get paid by the square inch. So you're gonna leave this company here with 28 pointless words and circles. And then idiots like me have to come in and train a woman that earns $12 an hour to live the brand. Where the fuck do you want to start with this? Yeah? It's too much. So, and again, they weren't deliberately doing bad work. They just didn't know what they were doing. This is when you think that positioning is an end in itself. You know, it's about the chart. It's not. It's about its head. Yeah? What are the three things? And branding is not complex until you let the morons make it complex. I have two objectives. He has to know that I exist. And he has to think the things that I want him to think. That's it. Trust me, that's not easy. It's real simple. Try doing it. It's really hard, right? But it's impossible with shit like that at the start of your strategy, right? Remember the game of telephone? In China, they call it goose goose in Mandarin. In America, they call it Chinese whispers. In France, they call it the telephone arabe, right? You whisper a word into the ear of the person next to you and they whisper it all the way down. And the person at the end shouts out what they think they heard. And if you use a really complicated word, it morphs and changes and alters. But if you use a simple word, it stays the same. This is the game of branding, right? If I've got three words, I can probably get it into my marketing department, into my advertising, into my sales force, into my customer. They're actually going to act that way. But if I've got super complex stuff, it's never going to happen, yeah? That's the game of position. So let me show you a good example with the time we've got left. So my favorite example of all time. So Hublot is one of the brands of LVMH, yeah? And Hublot is a relatively young luxury brand. It was invented in 1980 by a Swiss entrepreneur called Carlo Crocco. And Carlo really liked to dive, and he was into the sea and everything. And so he designed this beautiful watch in the 1980s, which was very expensive, probably about 30,000 Singapore dollars today's money, which Hublot means porthole. There's kind of like a nautical influence here. But what made it special was it was the first watch to have a rubber strap, especially with an expensive, you know, rose gold face. And today, many of us have rubber straps, right? Back then, unheard of. And it became known as the gold and rubber brand. And then when Carlo retired, he sold the brand to Jean-Claude Bivet, who's pretty much the most famous watchmaker in the world, and who now runs watches and jewelry for LVMH. And Mr. Bivet realized that he had to understand what was at the heart of the brand in order to make it special. So Mr. Bivet comes up with a one-word brand positioning. And rather than me tell you, I'll let Mr. Bivet explain how he worked out.
Hublot came out with a product in 1980, a product that was based on an innovation to introduce rubber as a strap. It seems very common today, but rubber in 1980 was a real courageous move. It was even a provocation. People said, hey, on a gold watch, rubber? Because people didn't know rubber comes from a tree, rubber is natural, rubber is very comfortable, it's very flexible, and rubber is very resistant, and it's waterproof. So finally, it's ideal for a watch. And then Hublot could not evolve. They stayed on a product. And I said, we are not a product. We have a message first. We have a concept. And the concept is fusion. Why? Because in 1980, when we put gold together with rubber, we created a fusion, because gold and rubber never come together. They were together only one time in life, during the Big Bang. Then everything was in one. And then rubber went away and said, okay, I go now on my tree. And gold said, okay, I go and rest in South Africa. And since then, they never met. Till people take them and connect them. So I said, Hublot made a fusion. And fusion must be our message, must be our philosophy, must be our religion. And once we have this religion clear, and it is named fusion, then we can develop further products that not necessarily need the rubber anymore. Because fusion goes further away than just rubber. It can be carbon, it can be ceramic, whatever. So I was capable to free Hublot from the product and give Hublot a message. And from that message, new products were born.
So, I mean, you don't always get it as tight as one word, right? But you see the power of it, right? If you can get it down to two or three together, it's a much more activated concept. Now, hand in hand with DNA, LVMH for many years, we've used the concept of codes. And here again, Baron Sharp, it's interesting, he's come up with the same concept. He calls them distinctive assets in his book. We call them codes in LVMH. It's exactly the same concept used in exactly the same way. And that's an interesting coincidence. And he talks about how all these things are distinctive assets that allow you to be distinctive in the market. Meanwhile, we were in Paris learning the same thing. So what are codes? Every brand has a logo. But good brands, well-run brands, also have other distinctive symbolic assets that the customer immediately recognizes, okay? So let's do some examples. This is not the logo of the company, but which company is it? Yes, very good. It's like an eye test, we'll get hard. How about this one?
Hermes.
Hermes, very good. This one?
Valentino.
No, too many women in the room.
Gentlemen. Ferrari,
very good. Oh, you're a dangerous woman, you are. You know. This one.
iPhone.
Good, iPhone. This one. No, nice guess. It's Clicquot yellow. This one.
Dom
Perignon. Dom Perignon, yeah. Point is, these things are incredibly valuable to a brand once you have them. Let me illustrate. So this is a wonderful ad for which brand?
Kenzo.
How do you know it's Kenzo? I took the pack shot, I took the logo out. How do you know?
Flowers.
Because this is a properly done ad. 5% of them are. Look, it's codified. It's codified. There are three codes here, right? What are the codes of Kenzo? The poppy red, the lacquer red, and the Asian in Paris, yeah? We don't need the pack shop to recognize that this is Kenzo, right? Most advertising passes you buy because it's done by entirely overly creative agencies that haven't got a clue what they're doing, right? They'd make the same ad for your competitor if they asked them, right? You have to, this is your real estate. It must be codified, like the windows. In Singapore, a lot of the retailers think the windows are pieces of glass that you look through. Window is the number one strategic asset you have, right? You codify the crap out of windows. Anyway, and here's Clicquot Yellow as well. Now, Australia is the world's worst place, okay? So, four codes, I should add, right? So, I don't know if you've ever visited or know any of our famous Australian fashion brands, but I wonder if you can guess which brand is which.
No, man.
Anyone care to guess? So, here's the answers, right? Oh, no, they're not. Sorry, I got that wrong. Here's the answers. No, there's the answer. No, that's the answer. No. My point is they're entirely exchangeable with each other. Without the logos, which incidentally are all the same, they look entirely identical, right? And these are the logos of the top 10 fashion brands in Australia. And those of you with a graphic background might notice something, right? And I didn't make them black and white, they're all black anyway. They're all black, right? You may be able to notice something. And if you look carefully here, you can spot it. Can you spot it? But if you ever come to Melbourne, do visit David Jones and Meyer, our two giant competing department stores. Because next to them, next to each of them, and they've both spent $1 billion this year refitting, you'll discover they've managed to create identical stores. At some point, you would have thought that one of the teams might have, I don't know, popped outside and looked next door and gone, it looks exactly the same as our major competitor next door. But no one did that. This is an astonishing act of stupidity. I could knock a door between these two, and people would walk in and out of these stores without realizing they're in somewhere. It's an extraordinary miss. There's one brand that does it well called Peter Alexander, and he's a sleepwear brand, and I just adore what he does. He's the only one that gets it. Every other Australian brand is totally shit at this. Murky Media. Right, let's go hard with this as we approach our close. There has never been a dirtier time in media, and I'm not sure how much you want me to talk about this, but let's talk about it anyway. There's three things wrong with murky media. Media placement. Now, I did this talk, oh God, 3 weeks ago, so I'm looking pretty smart at the moment, given Google share prices down 15% because of this today. Media placement, agency transparency, which is another word for saying the agency's on the tape, and programmatic supply chain. Let's go through all three in dirty, dirty detail. You ready? So, this is the problem that now afflicts Google. So, this is The Guardian, one of the most left-wing newspapers in the UK. And I don't know who these handsome gentlemen are, but I don't. They're on some kind of wing, but it isn't the left wing of British society. And what you see here is what programmatic does, yeah? It places ads, theoretically, you know, connected to audiences, but I never read The Guardian, but the point is, most brands now are discovering with any kind of programmatic spend that their ads are slightly, occasionally appearing on sites for neo-Nazis, jihadists, pornography, anti-Semites, and so on. And most brands, as you know, are incredibly paranoid about their reputation these days and spend millions on it, and are now pulling budgets as we speak from Google and Facebook because they can't put up with this. And Google has a problem because, believe it or not, and Facebook too, they are not media channels. They've always denied being media channels. Why would Facebook and Google say they're not a media channel when they clearly are? Because the minute they admit that, then they have to take responsibility for what they're broadcasting. So they're tech companies, see? And if this happens, it's the fault of the people that posted this on their tech platform. It's a game that's coming to an end, but it's a game that has enormous implications. So the first problem is media placement. And you might start to worry about programmatic here, right? Because if programmatic's really good, why is this happening, yeah, in the first place? Next, the murky, fraudulent media supply chain. Not my words, the words of Mark Pritchard, the head of marketing at P&G. Murky and fraudulent. So, in Singapore, I've noticed in particular, everyone's mad for programmatic and technology. Let me show you how programmatic actually works. And this is a chart that comes from a number of different places. You ready? You should share this with your colleagues and friends. So you know how programmatic works, right? It's an automated buying system, super efficient, taking out all the weak links, yeah? The future of advertising, growing at 30% a year. All right, so here's 100% of your advertising budget that you commit to programmatic, okay? 5% of that will go to your agency in the form of a reduced commission. That's fine, we kind of know that these days. It used to be 15%, these days it's 5%. 15% will go to the trading desk that actually makes the programmatic buy. 10% will go to the DSP that does the demand side analysis. 25% will go into data targeting and verification, which is just basically clipping the ticket with ad tech. And 5% for the actual exchange. So when I was a young man, we used to complain about agencies taking a 15% commission. Geez, that's looking pretty good these days, because right now, 60% of your money has gone before you've bought a single inch of media with programmatic. 60%. So you've got 40% of your money going into the media. No, you don't. No, you don't. 40% could go into your media, but then we've got to take bots into the equation at this point. Because whatever we're being told by media agencies, bots continue to occupy a significant proportion of the digital videos. Now, you could say it's 10% of the audience. That would be nonsense. There's no one, not even the digital companies, that believes it's 10%. An accurate estimate is probably 30%. Many put it at 70%. So by now, I've taken another 12% of my money out because it's being watched by a bot. And you're left at the end with 28 cents in the dollar. How do you like that? That's what programmatic is right now. Now, that's not my stupid chart. That comes from the World Federation of Advertisers. That was their estimate. Ubiquity, who do analysis of this, came to the same numbers. And The Guardian, in a stroke of genius, bought their own media through programmatic and got 30 cents in the dollar when it went through. So there's three different sources all confirming that this is roughly the situation. Now, why has no one told you about this, and why is programmatic growing at 25% a year? And the answer, if you're ready, is nobody knows what they're doing anymore. Why did no one know about this until the Times ran a story on it a month ago? Because nobody knows what they're doing anymore. Nobody. No one's in control of it, no one's monitoring it. It's completely out of control. And it looks efficient, but it's not. Finally, agency transparency. What does that mean? It means most agencies are pervasively not transparent with client money, and there are massive firestorms brewing in terms of relationships between agencies and clients. Mark Pritchard's story is probably the most interesting one. So Pritchard's very fair, and he gave a speech last month in Miami where he said he discovered an agency using what's called a value bank. So one of the many different ways. So, in a nutshell, what happens is the media agencies now are being really, really held back on, let's say, a 5% commission. So they have to make their money elsewhere, because otherwise it wouldn't be profitable. And so these other non-transparent ways of making money are dominating the world of media. And one of the things Pritchard discovered was one of his big media agencies was buying media on behalf of P&G, and one of the things they get as a result of that is what's called a value bank or a SER commission. So not only do they buy the media, but the platform they buy it for says, and because you gave us that order, I will give you 10% of free media back. Now, legally in America, they have to return that 10% to the client, not here in Singapore. But they don't. They sell it to other clients and make money on the side. Pritchard discovered it and said to the agency, I know that you've got a value bank from us and you didn't give us the money back. And the agency said, yeah. It says in the contract that we were allowed to resell that. And he said, I didn't know that. And they went, yeah, well, there you go. That's a perfect story of how clients and agencies are all, again, not really aware of what the hell is going on at the moment. But again, these transparency issues will be huge. Finally, let's end with zero-based budgeting. So, to understand zero-based budgets, which will change the world of marketing in the next 5 years, we have to, zero-based comes from PFIR's book in the 1970s. It doesn't belong in the world of marketing. A number of firms, specifically 3G and Kraft Heinz, brought private equity-based budgeting into marketing, and as a result, it's become the dominant approach. Now, Unilever have moved to zero-based 12 months ago, as have Mondelez, as have P&G and Coca-Cola. Right. So, to understand the power of zero-based budgeting, you have to appreciate how stupid almost every company in Singapore is in how they set their marketing budgets. You ready? This is not made up, this is true. You ready? I don't know the exact figure, it'd be more than 90%, right? If I try to explain this to a child, they'd go, what are you talking about, right? Here you go. So, here's how you get your marketing budget in Singapore. A finance executive, maybe in Singapore, maybe in Zurich, perhaps in London, looks at your sales figures for 2016, okay? Let's say you've done 10 million SGD, okay? Then she applies a basic CAGR, compound annual growth rate, and says, all over the last 5 years, you've grown on average by 10% a year. She applies the CAGR to last year's revenue figure and goes, you know what? You're $11 million. That's what you're going to make next year. Then she comes up with what's called an advertising to sales ratio, all right? Which in this case is 5% of sales. She multiplies 5% by 11 million, and she works out your marketing budget will be $550,000, okay? That's pretty much how every company here in Singapore does it, okay? Now, let's pause and appreciate how completely bamboozly stupid the whole thing is, right? First of all, if I already know how much money I'm going to make next year, why am I fucking bothering with doing any marketing at all? It's a good question, right? Second, where does the 5% come from? Why isn't it 3? Why isn't it 6? Does anyone know where the 5% comes from? It comes from a special database called the SOMA database that every CFO has access to. And SOMA, S-O-M-A, stands for straight out of my ass. They just make it up. Finally, why would a woman who lives in Zurich, who's never been to Singapore, doesn't know the market, never looked at any of the research, how come she's in charge of the investment levels for the organization? This is crazy. And yet, it is the predominant approach to budgeting. So, zero base is the future. Now, marketers go, oh God, I don't understand how that's got a zero in it. Don't panic, right? It means we start with no pre-allocated amount. And crucially, back to our friend Adidas, we start with no pre-allocated amounts going to one media or another, okay? What we do is we put our plan together, we do our research, our segmentation, we write proper objectives, we work out what the value of those objectives are, and we brief our agencies to say how much will it cost to achieve those objectives. And then we present our plan to senior management. It ends with something that most marketing plans in Singapore don't have, a proposal. If you give me X in terms of investment, I will guarantee you Y in terms of return, okay? Now I've put zero-based budgeting into a couple of big multinationals. It's not perfect, but it works pretty good. Because after about 2 years, you get to spot the good marketers. And the good marketers are the ones that give us our money, yeah? And the shit ones are the ones that never give us our money. And I like that as a definition of what is good marketing, because I think it's the most important one, right? There's a guy in Australia called Nick Hagen who works for a medical company called Baxter. And his nickname is, you remember Karl Malone, the basketball player? Some of you are old enough to remember Karl Malone. He's a very famous basketball player. He had a nickname. You remember what the nickname of Karl Malone was? He was called the mailman. Why did they call him the mailman? He always fucking delivers. And Hagen's the mailman there, right? So whatever he asks for now, the CEO always gives it to him. Because if he asks for $2 million and it's twice what we thought he wanted to spend, he's going to give us the $18 million incrementally promised us. And he's been doing it for 8 years, right? You want that system in place. You want the crap marketers to not have much money and the good ones to get more of it. And that's what starts to happen, right? And for that reason, zero base is rapidly becoming the default system. If you haven't encountered it yet, within 2 years, you certainly will. Let's end on a high note then. So, if you remember the Christian faith, it's often you'd often see this what would Jesus do thing. And it's a very good idea, which is if you find yourself in a bar or a strip club or something, you ask yourself WWJD, right? And it guides your, well, it's true, it guides your activities, right? Our bumper sticker says, what would your brand position tell you to do? And the whole point of positioning is it should guide the executions of everything we do. I think consistency, however, is overrated, right? I like brands when they smash up a category, yeah? Brands aren't meant to be like other brands. They're meant to be completely different, right? And the disruption word is overused, but this is one place where brands should disrupt a category. You know, I don't have a mobile phone, I have an iPhone, right? I don't have a wallet like Srini, I have a Beluti piece of beautiful stuff, right? These brands have transcended the category, right? So let me give you a good example of that. So Krug is an amazing brand. I mean, it's just amazing, right? Of the top 10 champagnes right now, about 7 of them are from Krug, right? It's not that big a house. And a few years ago, Henri Krug, who is tragically no longer alive, was running the house, did an amazing thing. Henri launched the 1989 vintage of Krug ahead of the 1988 vintage. And so they're out of sequence, yeah? And the Apple, you can skip a vintage in champagne, but you can never put them out of sequence. And the people in charge of the champagne category wrote him a letter saying, you can't do that. You can't bring that one out before that one because it's out of sequence. And Henri wrote them back a really nice, polite letter saying, don't ever tell me how to make Krug ever again. Right? And the whole point of Henri's thing is, I don't make champagne. That's maybe what you do. I make Krug. Yeah? And if I think I need to do that, I'm going to do that because I don't care. The rules, all the rules, category rules, all bullshit, yeah? They're just constraints, yeah? There aren't really any rules at all, yeah? There's just your brand and how you play the game. And that sounds like a Tom Cruise movie, but it turns out to be true, yeah? It's not. So if I was going to write a book on branding, and I'm certainly not because there's no money in it, and it's a waste of time. If I was going to write a book on branding, I would call it disruptively consistent. This is what I've learned about great brands, right? And particularly the brands of LVMH. They are consistent to their position, to their DNA. As a result, they are disruptive to the category and to the business, right? Krug is being true to the DNA. The DNA of Krug is the refined maverick. True to that, and therefore disruptive to the category. Real brands, strong brands, that's what they do. And if it was successful, I'd write a sequel called Consistently Disruptive. Yeah? I think if you look at what really great brands do, they deliver on the position and they smash the category. And to finish, let's look at what Hublot did. Do you remember the positioning of Hublot? Fusion of two contradictory different elements, right? Let me show you how Hublot executes on its position, right? So, first of all, product names, right? So I think Rolex is the world's most boring brand, right? I wouldn't, if someone offered me a free Rolex, I wouldn't take it because it's so pathetically boring, right? The Rolex, if you look at the Rolex names, they're called like, you know, Seafarer 4. And then they're like, oh, the next one's going to be called Seafarer 5, you know? Hublot uses its DNA, fusion, for the names. Big Bang for the men and for the ladies. Tutti Frutti. Their DNA drives their choice of endorser. So when they looked for someone to endorse their Big Bang watch, they went with Diego Maradona. Now, some of you won't know Diego Maradona. He's a very famous retired footballer. He's a genius. He broke all the rules. He did enough drugs to kill a small horse. He's the opposite of Roger Federer on every possible variant, okay? And when they brought him in for the meeting, he said to Mr. Beaver, I want the number 10, because he wore the number 10 during the soccer. And Mr. Beaver said, no, I will give you two watches, the number 1 and the number 0, and you will wear them together. Google has spent a lot of money developing Magic Gold, which is a ceramic paste that combines expensive gold with ceramic, which is a very beautiful paste. And the reason is very simple. If we're about fusion, we don't use pure materials, we must use alloys. So it drives the product development. But the final and most important reason why I picked this is look at how they advertise. So you've all seen boring commodity advertising for watches, right? you find a celebrity that nobody hates but nobody particularly loves, right? That's sort of a happy vanilla flavor, right? No one hates Roger Federer, right? If you said to me, I fucking hate Roger Federer, I'd go, something's wrong with you, right? There's nothing to hate. But if you said to me, God, I love Roger Federer, he inspires me every day, I'd be like, yeah. So you find someone that no one likes or dislikes. You roll up his wrist and you go, oh, yeah, look at my watch, right? And you'll see that generic approach again and again and again and again forever, right? This won't damage the brands, but it's commodity generic category thinking. This is how Hublot does it. So 3 years ago, 4 years ago now, Bernie Eccleston, who's just retired as the CEO of Formula One, was coming out of his London apartment wearing an Hublot King Power watch. And the guy was waiting for him at the bottom of the steps to steal his watch. And Bernie, despite being 80 years old and 5'2" tall, put up a fight. And the thief had to beat him unconscious to take his watch. And it made quite a lot of headlines. And Bernie was badly beaten. I mean, it was a severe incident, right? Anyway, Bernie goes down to the police station and they take the crime photos to show the, you know, the scars and everything. And Bernie says, here, give me one of those photographs. And he writes on the back of it, because he's very good friends with Mr. Beaver, look what some people will do to get their hands on an Hublot, and sends it to Mr. Beaver in Switzerland. Mr. Beaver's sitting there in Switzerland at the start of December, and this player arrives and he opens it, he gets this picture of Bernie, all beaten up, and he goes, this will be our Christmas advertising campaign. This is the ad that they ran. Full-page Financial Times, full-page Wall Street Journal, full-page China Daily. Now, clearly it's disruptive, right? But it's also consistent. What could be more consistent to fusion than the richest man in London being beaten up by the poorest man in London over a Hublot watch? Note something else. If you like Rolex, this is appalling. But you were never going to buy a Hublot anyway. In this room, there's six people that find this arousing, right? The rest of you are either turned off or confused by it. But at $30,000 a watch, we just need six, yeah? And that's another important lesson. When there's 100 brands hunting for you, being the number three or number four Roger Federer-style brand isn't going to get you anywhere, right? Pick a small group and make them very aroused. And who cares about everyone else, right? If I have to insult them to make my six aroused, that's fine, right? Because at the end of the day, I choose my target, and I go hard for them, and don't worry about everyone else. So 9 lessons, you ready? Targeting, I think that's in a big debate that will get stronger. Brands over time need to change. Media neutrality is a big issue. You can't be media neutral if your badge says digital marketer. The sooner we lose the dreary D word, which will inevitably happen, the better. Killing brands is a key to success. Brand DNA. You don't have to call it DNA, but a tight definition of the brand. And the definition of tight is you can remember it without a PowerPoint slide. Code-free execution is a real problem. Two or three codes can change your execution. Great murkiness in the media supply chain, and it's getting murkier. Zero-based budgeting is coming, and it's a good thing. And finally, with executions, try to be bold and disruptive. Thank you very much.